You know, I mean, the thing about this is there is karmic law. You know, there is karmic law. And just because we don't think of it doesn't mean it isn't real. Just because we're living in the present doesn't mean that there aren't chains, thick chains of required consequence that are coming, that exist upon humanity, that are unseen and haven't manifest fully. I mean, thick chains, basically by being party to such destruction and harm having been done for the last few hundred years. I mean, before that too, but, you know, and it will remain with them for a while beyond this 3D cycle. In many ways, Orion is preparing for the next cycle, and there are going to be a lot of people who are with less opportunity next time around. I mean, Orion is a whole hell of a lot more clever than the humans to whom they give little toys. These souls are being bound to servitude to Orion for future incarnations. They're binding themselves by their consent to their relationship with the negative ETs. That is going to continue for them into the next cycle and on other planets. They have no idea about that. They think that it's some kind of game, and they think that because they're doing fine now and they got some perks, they're going to continue. That is not the case. And there are going to be a lot of enslaved humans next round, I assure you. So it's already starting, and Orion is a whole lot more clever than their human followers, I'll tell you that. So these people are all going to pay for their deals that they made. They're on the hook in ways they can't understand, and that's going to last for a long, long time. You know, if you cut a deal with the devil, don't think that you're going to get out easy. don't think that you're winning, because you don't see the chains that are being established now. Oh, I think there's perfect balance. I think that, you know, it's really a good question, because a lot of people think like that, and it doesn't seem like things are fair. I never think that there's no balance, personally. I don't think that way it's out of balance. I think about karmic stream. And, you know, karmic analysis is key to understanding conditions in the here and now, right? So personal emotion is very minor as a guide to, it's useful, but it's secondary as a guide to understanding current conditions or any current situation. So by karmic analysis, what I see is that there are zones of greater and lesser karmic liability. And so different planet Earth as a whole is made up of people who don't care about each other, and who are basically selfish, and basically materialistic, and basically small-minded, and basically corruptible, easy to be purchased, and easy to be led. They're really quite easy. Once you get to certain levels of intelligence, it's very, very easy to become their demigod. So it's not a big deal. And so a population like that binds itself further. This is a time when, that which has been hidden, that which is hidden, is being further revealed. This is the time of revelation, right? That's what apocalypse means. Apocalypse is a revealing. And so it's hard to say, first of all, whether the greater magnitude of evil or negativity that we see is a result of more negativity or just the closer vision of it. You know, if I put my hand out, I've done this many times, if I put my hand out, I see my hand and I see, you know, space around it and the walls and all that. If I bring my hand closer and closer to my eye, my whole world becomes that hand. And there's nothing else but the hand. Now, did the hand get to be, oh my God, my hand is the size of a universe? No. I'm simply seeing it closer. And so this is a perceptual thing. Is the evil greater, or is it less hidden? Is it greater, or are we actually simply more aware of it? Because we're more sensitive. We have sensitized ourselves to the dynamics of, you know, well-being and not well-being. So I'm not sure. I mean, you know, Ra said, and we can understand it, the fourth density energy development intensifies the activity of both polarized groups, positive, negative. So we don't see the work of the Confederation. We see down here on the ground the, you know, disasters and the controls of the negatives. So we, first of all, don't see the other side because it's hidden. And what's negative is certainly intensifying for sure and increasing. What's positive is increasing too, but again, it's invisible. So that's an unbalanced view. And also, we are more sensitive to it and we're seeing its dynamics more clearly. I never think there's no balance. I simply see that in different areas, the latent corruptibility of Earth humans is now materializing their cages, the cage of mind by the corruptibility of the humans. Meaning, you know. I was just watching a video, and the people are standing there like robots, and they're smiling, and they're waving, and they're high-fiving each other, and they're doing just what the daddy says, you know, in the 10,000 member congregation. I mean, you know, what do you expect from for a group like that? They deserve servitude. I mean, you deserve servitude if you act like a slave to liars. So, if you think that you're, you know, that those liars, those leaders, are holy men, then you deserve imprisonment, because you're already imprisoned yourself by selling yourself out, by not believing in yourself and transferring your trust out of the self, but to this fancy one. It's amazing. I mean, you know. Thousands and thousands of people standing and swaying, and yes, Holy Father, and yes, preacher, you know, we gotta do that. I mean, that's the majority here, right? That's the majority. Hundreds of millions around the world like that. Hundreds of millions. So all of them will find a harder time come next round. It's all becoming clear to me that there's a lot of jockeying here for the next cycle. The Orion action is significantly for the next cycle. They're already given up on this cycle, by the way. So, doesn't mean there won't be shit coming, but the greater work is establishing structures in mind collectively so that they will be successful in the next planet. What I mean is the higher ups know Earth is going 4D positive. They also are very aware of the limitations, you know, because the time is almost up here. and they're going to get a big mess when they pull the plug. And it's not really what was ordered from upstairs. So the greater work, you know, is to prepare for tomorrow. And the bigger tomorrow is the next cycle where these souls are going, the next 3D planets, and establishing patterns in the mind of Earth humanity that'll carry over to the next incarnation, right, on another 3D rock. That's how I see it. I don't mean they've given up and went away or anything, but they know what's not going to happen here, and they're gunning for a bigger cache next time. Well, keep in mind that, you know, you also focus your studies and your learning on the negative doings, and that the positive is really invisible. Not only the Confederation actions are invisible, but you know, the little things, right? An 8-year-old boy helps his 6-year-old sister to do her homework. You know, that happens every day, you know. It's never in the news. And the father says thank you to his wife. Or the grandmother takes the kids to school. Now, I'm not idealizing, romanticizing that either, but there are countless episodes, instances of goodly action, goodly interaction, and that's completely unregistered, you know? I mean, it's called fear porn, right? There is a certain fascination we have with the dark. That's why people get on the dark path, because there's something like, wow, that's cool. Even though it's evil, there's a sense of, wow, that's cool. And the people who follow the negative, the mid-level, they have that view too. So no, I don't think that it's out of balance at all, but I think it's a matter of where you're looking. And I think it's a matter of that the benevolent is basically hidden by the media, of course, and also hidden by design by Confederation. They're not interested in publicizing what they do because they don't want trouble. And also, that's not what humans need to know, you know? It's like the reason that you can't see inside your body is because you don't need to know what's inside it. If you needed to know, it would be transparent. So at this level, it's not necessary for us to know a lot of the positive machinery or the positive infrastructure of planetary support that keeps things going. So, and when Jesus said the poor will always be with us, if he said that, I am sure he meant the poor of spirit of humans. The poor of spirit of humanity. And they'll be with us in the next cycle, in another 3D world too. And some of the younger wanderers will be there. It's called the law of karma, which is, if you're acting with a very confused motive, particularly in deliberately harming others, you definitely need a taste of your own medicine. You have to taste your own medicine, because his morality is baffled morality. Baffling, Ra uses that term a couple of times, is probably a more technical word for chakra energy blockage. The energy moving up is baffled by blockage or distortion in mind. And this is a person who basically, you know, is a real young soul in some way, at least in the moral accounting. And so, you see, bad karma means you deserve suffering. That's what it means. Bad karma means the person needs suffering. Now that's mediated by higher self. That's not, you know, that's not some negative ET. Now negative ETs are negative humans of, you know, they basically carry out the operations of karmic balancing. Although they themselves are continuing on the negative path, and they themselves may be very damaged goods, as they usually are. So, yet, you know, there's the term for Genghis Khan or someone, one of those guys, Attila the Hun. The term is the scourge of God. The scourge of God. And that's basically the operation of a negative who is doing their own thing and just so happens to be the instrument of karmic readjustment for the souls that encounter them. Yeah, there's a mechanical aspect to it, and then there's very karma is above higher self. So, without the mind of higher self, we see little, and even higher self needs to call in the big gun for karmic decision. The big gun being the seventh density self that's in touch across the octave. Yeah, there's some aspect of karma with the operation of what we call negative karma. There, I'm a beginner. I don't know anything. So, but in my view, the first aspect is a somewhat mechanistic, purely quantitative rebalancing, meaning a certain quality out demands a certain catalyst in. It must be, or it has to be for there to be a further movement out of merely the experiencing of the catalyst, which is called choice. You know, so the first aspect of karmic return, I think, is a squaring of the books, a settling of accounts. Just like it's a mathematics. It's purely quantitative. It's mechanistic in the sense that a certain type of disharmony expressed, again, it depends on the soul and what path they're on and where on the path and the nature of what they put out. But regardless of, you know, factoring in all those variables in general, one level of the karmic return, I believe, is simply a settling of accounts. It's not an account with another person. It's an account at the level of soul, to right the soul, R-I-G-H-T, to put it, you know, to put the ship back in even keel. And that's when the pendulum gets swung way to the left, then there's going to be a swing far to the right, and it has to be. It's probably simply an energetic balancing mechanism. And the second level of it, then, or after that occurs, or when that's provided substantially or adequately, there's also the dynamic of opportunity for revaluation of choice or revaluation of path. It's a revaluation of what's considered significant. You know, if I take money because I need money and do this kind of harming consistently, it indicates that my moral values are a little immature. Because, sure, everybody needs money, that's fine. But I'm willing to really harm people in this way. It's not an extreme harm, but I'm willing to do mental harm, mental violence, to get a paycheck. Now, that will not cut it on the negative path. You have to be much more clear about the path than that to harvest or to proceed far on the negative path. So there's some moral confusion and moral immaturity there. That's the opportunity by his suffering. Whatever suffering will be coming to this fellow, I imagine it'll be mental suffering. He deserves his mental suffering. I mean, I think people have a little bit excess compassion for the evildoer. A lot of people who are love over wisdom. It's the love over wisdom approach. But I think the love over wisdom has what's called, it's, you know, there's a term for it. It's called idiot compassion. That's the term Chogyam Trungpa used, idiot compassion. And that's love without wisdom. And idiot compassion says, oh, well, he was just misguided. We should be nice to him. That's not the way the universe works. The universe works, strongly. And if one was strongly off-center, then one will be strongly corrected or strongly treated as catalyst, so the person can strongly affirm their desire to stay on path. And so the universe does not operate by idiot compassion, but by ruthless compassion. Ruthless absolutely non-sentimental compassion. I mean, everybody who's suffering, you know, is getting what they deserve. Of course there are karmic lords. The lords of karma are eighth density beings, as far as I know, at the level, and they'd be called cosmic Buddhas. You know, it's like the Buddha said, if you remember the leaves of the handful of leaves sutta in the original, the Buddha indicated that what he knows is like all the leaves in the trees of the forest, while what he says is just the leaves in his hand, that quantity. They know a lot. And yes, it's a high matter. So the universe definitely doesn't do idiot compassion. And everybody who's suffering gets just what they deserve. It's very hard to say if it's been readjusted yet, or the post-action required reaction has been received and discharged, the charge discharged. It's hard to say. I do believe that one of the methods used by the lords of karma is called bundling. And they basically take, I'm sure it's in accord with the dynamics of light, the structure of transformation of light. Because, you know, the mind is light too, right? The mind and the soul are light or energy also, and they have their own intrinsic patterning. And so when they get into a non-functional state or distorted state, they have their own inbuilt mechanisms of recorrection, self-correcting. You know, the universe is a self-correcting mechanism at the mechanistic level, which is the level of, you know, metaphysics. It's the science of multidimensional light transmission or processing. So I don't know. I think in the bundling, many, many small things end up accumulating or building, and payback or the return portion of the cycle is unrecognized or does not occur. Until it builds up to a certain amount, and then you get have one of those terrible days, you know, or a period of a week when all sorts of crap happens. I think it's like that. Yeah, you know, these things are not accidental. And so, I mean, I've had that always, meaning periodically. When it rains, it pours. That's the phrase. So when trouble comes, there's often an accumulative, and, you know, there's a a significant quantity discharged or precipitated into manifestation, like salt coming out of solution in a cup of water. When you add one more grain, grain of salt, immediately it starts snowing in the cup, and it all comes out of solution because of saturation. So I believe that there's a certain kind of energy saturation, or a point of saturation point. It's a strange word, saturation, maybe related to Saturn, which is the, you know, giver of or manager of karma. So Saturnian point of maximal capacity to keep something in time-space, after which it must manifest in space-time. You know, the straw that broke the camel's back. The camel had a bad back for a long time, you know, and he needed a break, but nobody gave him a break, and so they just put another straw on, and then he fell down. And it's because there have been unrecognized gradual accumulation of a need for rebalancing manifest and expressed in the physical, in space-time. So the visible, you know, that's the thing about dimensional shift, I'd say, and that's my argument for both, basically, for gradual leading to instantaneous, which is that systems make quantum change by unseen gradual accumulation of energy, you know, power to achieve a new condition, and then at a moment it appears. And it's not that it's new, or it's new, but it's not that it happened in a minute. What happened in a minute happened after decades or millennia. So what? There is no instantaneous. Actually, there's simply instantaneous manifestation of that which had been very, very significantly growing, unseen, for a very long time. It's just the next step. It isn't actually instantaneous. It's the next step in a very long gradual process in which, for the first time, the next step is precipitation, precipitate into manifestation. So you can wonder, who are all those guys being tortured? Those are the guys who are reversing path. Those are the guys who are not clear what path they're on. Yes, absolutely. Some of these people are Nazis, and everybody gets what they deserve. That actually, the me experiencing now is the me who did it then, even though it's a different body and personality. It's the same soul. So the soul is what persists. The soul is very much the significator of mind, and that persists out of space-time in time-space. And it's very subtle, because it's not the whole self, it's just an aspect. But the portion of soul consciousness that is the conscious agent doing the negative action is the same portion of soul consciousness that is conscious in receiving, or consciously receiving, the payback, even if he doesn't know about karma. Yes, yes, precise and targeted. Yeah, well, the part that screwed up before is the part that gets the payback. You know, it's a very interesting thing. I'm starting to realize that, you know, the self is not a self. The self is a composite. And you know, it's like I look at a five-year-old child and I see so happy face, so happy, happy, really an angel, really from heaven. And then I look at their 10-year-old brother or sister, and half of it is lost, or part of it is lost. And then you look at their 16-year-old brother or sister, and it's really all lost. And then you look at the parents, and they're kind of, you know, frustrated and overlaid with lots of distortion. And then you look at the grandparents, and they're starting to pull out of the conditioning. I'm realizing that the one who is the child is not the one who is the adult. It's not quite the same person. Something's not there. It hasn't actually been lost. It's not the same one. Now, I'm not saying that it's a possession or anything like that, but there's some, and I'm not saying there isn't continuity. There's the skandhas are still flowing along. The skandhas being the Buddhist understanding of what the constituents of self are. Form, body, feeling or sensation, perception or the means of apprehending experience, and then thoughts or volitional formations, mental formations, fermentations, thinking, you know, will-based thinking, feeling. And then there's consciousness. So form, feeling, perception, mental formations, and consciousness. And so that's those heaps or those elements interpenetrate and flow and go from one life to another. But it's almost like the portion of the soul that manifests in childhood is no longer manifesting when there's further distortion in mind. It's just not coming out. And in a way, you can say it's a different person. Not fully, but it has a different soul note. The soul note, the vibration of a child who's not been traumatized, is great love and joy. And that's closer to the heart of soul than what comes later, which is a confused teenager and then a burdened adult until they pull out and move towards the childlike elderly, or more move towards the childlike in elderly, and then die like a child, meaning very simple-minded. Not too happy, however, but simple. So, you know, that's the point returning, the zero returns to 360, or 360 is zero. The beginning is the end. So they're not quite the same person, the same soul, but a very a substantially different aspect or note of the soul. It just disappears. And I think it's similar to Ra, meaning if Don kept asking Ra certain questions about negative doings, Ra would be lost. But a voice would continue, and the voice would say, "I am Ra." Just like it said, "I am Yahweh," whoever that was or whatever that was, it's called a masquerade. So, because the conditions of mind change, the originating aspect of soul no longer comes through. And to a certain extent, that person is not the same, because they're manifesting distorted mind more than authentic soul note. The child manifests authentic soul note without mind development, with inadequate complexity of mind. You can say, I don't know whether it's distortion or complexity, but there is non-development of many portions of the mind. As that occurs, it acts as a filter, which actually blocks certain finer, more vulnerable aspects of consciousness or energy of other portions of soul. So, yeah, so anyway, I think that's what's going on. And I started to think, oh, that person's not there anymore. That happy one is gone. How strange. I would just say that, you know, aspects of the soul that are associated with joy and heart chakra, actually. It's really heart chakra. It's 4-6. The child's joy is very much a 4-6 blend. They don't have much wisdom. Forget that. But they're manifesting a lot of love and joy with unrecognized faith that all is good. The child can't say all is good, but they're living all is good. They live all is good. They live all is God. That's how they live. That's why people like them, if people are not too traumatized. There's a term from the Latin, and it means invalid from initiation. It's something like invalid ab initio. Initio means ab, means from. Initio means is initial, the root of initial. Initially at the initiation. It means illegitimate from the inception. In such a situation, it's called noble silence. Noble silence. And Buddha did that a lot. Buddha didn't answer every question. And sometimes people, he just didn't say anything. Somebody asked him something, he didn't say anything. Which is expressing displeasure or disinterest or non-relation. You know, you're too off, I'm not going to even touch it. You're so off, you don't even deserve a reply. And I think the thing is you've got to know your truth well and really make peace with the sadness that you're with these people. You see, there's anger at their arrogance, their mistaken, their false belief, the arrogance that comes with their false belief or their misunderstanding. So, you know, there's the presentation of wrong view in a humble way, and there's presentation of wrong view in an arrogant way. And arrogance often generates resistance for those, you know, meaning anger, in those who haven't processed deeper levels of the relationship or the situation. In my view, like we said before, the anger at those who listen not or those who arrogantly spout wrong view is our problem, of course, based in, I think, unrecognized sadness that we're there with them, with these fools, these people that don't really fit us. You know, the word fool, there's a whole section of the Dhammapada called the fool. That's a term the Buddha used. People used the fool. It doesn't mean, you know, you're an evil soul. It just means the mind is foolish. And we're afraid to call a spade a spade. And that's love, that's idiot compassion. So without idiot compassion, maybe, we would see these people and say, they're wrong, they're just quite wrong. And they're arrogant. Okay. And I don't really like them. And I don't really want to be here. But I know I'm here, and I know why I'm here, because I agreed. But I don't really want to be here. Okay. And I feel sad. I don't really like it here. I feel lonely. I'm here with these people. It's sad that I find myself here with these people. That's under the anger. That's under the anger. And if that level of heartbreak, mild heartbreak, or loneliness, if that's there, or if we recognize it, There's less anger. And then if we make peace with the broken heart of being with people we really don't like or don't want to be with, who cannot listen, who are not nice. Arrogant people are not nice. They're not nice. Because nice is not arrogant. Nice is, I think this is true, but I don't really know totally. Or I think, yes, this. But I'm not going to lord it over you. And I'm open to correction or seeing a bigger view. But many humans are not like that. So, you know, normally the more education, the more distortion. So the pride of the educated is their unrecognized parroting of the lies of the negative leadership. And then we really shouldn't be with them. But actually we are. Why? Well, of course, it's the result of our choices, it's our karma, it's very useful catalyst for our further development. And the further development, I'd say, in that situation is, number one, moving towards the deeper level basis of my anger, my self-understanding and acceptance, which is some kind of sadness and heartbreak and loneliness and self-pity. Which is also fine. But then there's a deeper level to that, which is, well, why the hell am I here anyway? I'm here because it's a sacrifice. Living on Earth is a sacrifice, if you haven't noticed. And the more we develop, the more that the degree of that sacrifice is recognized. Which really means we recognize, we realize how much we've lost. Because we're realizing more and more of who we are, what we are. The more you know what you are, the more you'll see how we cannot express it fully with the people around us. Which is the sacrifice. That's the sacrifice. The sacrifice is coming to a world which doesn't know love and doesn't know truth and doesn't value truth and doesn't value love. And that's why they follow lying leaders who are mind-controlled. What a tragic comedy. What a tragedy. They're following mind-controlled liars who themselves don't know what they're doing because they don't know the path or the way of creation. They don't know birth and death. They don't know soul evolution. Then we find ourselves with these people who are rightly called fools. A fool is one who arrogantly parrots wrong view. If you arrogantly parrot, like a parrot, wrong view, you are a fool. No, fine. It doesn't mean you're evil. It doesn't mean you're not God. You're God as a fool. God playing the fool. You know, same kind of thing. Those at the top are negative, uniformly, okay? Those in the middle are mixed, and those at the bottom are mixed. There's a higher percentage of positives in the bottom than the middle, and the lowest number of positives are at the top. And at the top, you know, you really have to go along to get along if you're not a full demon. But generally, they prefer full committed demons. So, which means those who basically now believe that pain is pleasure. And that's the result of mind control. So it's interesting. I imagine some of the percentage of those who get into 4D negative realize that they're they didn't know what they were doing. I guess it's possible to be so negative by mind. Maybe it's possible. I'm not sure. I can't imagine, but maybe it's possible to be so negative by mind control that you harvest 4D negative, and then on the other side you realize, oh my God, I really don't want to be a slave. This whole master-slave thing is just not what I want. Yes, that's a bullseye there. That I totally agree, and you're absolutely right. And that I completely, that's a very, very, very clear, wise point there. Where you found the heart of it. That is extremely positive for people. Because you're right, lots of people have fear. Yeah, you know, it's funny. To me, it's so clear there's no death. But most everybody, you know, they're not focusing on what's essential. They're spending a lot of time in the inessentials, anonymity, distraction, and sleep, as Ross said. and very significantly dishonest. People are really significantly dishonest to themselves. And that's really, you know, if you go through your life avoiding what's painful or avoiding what's confusing, that is important, you're going to have a hard time at the end. So people live the life without understanding it. And so, right, you know, you can avoid reality, but you can't avoid the consequences of reality or the consequences of avoiding. And so at the moment of death, they're facing the consequences of avoiding consideration of life and death, birth and death. You know, in Buddhism, they don't even say life and death, they say birth and death. And I realized yesterday that that's correct. It isn't life and death because death is not the opposite of life. Death is the opposite of birth. And birth and death are both life, and what happens before and after all, each, is also life. Life before birth, life after death. So it should be birth and death. So I corrected myself. So yeah, so it's sad, right? A lot of people are very upset. It's sad. People live their whole life and then they get to the point closer and closer to the end, and they're extremely anxious and scared. Yeah, you know, I mean, humanity has, they don't know what hit them. They don't know what hit them. They grow up and they're pushed this way and they're pushed that way and they're led this way and that way. Sometimes completely in accord with their own desires, which are then, you know, carefully by their own desires, they're carefully shepherded where the controlling forces want them, buying goods, being a good consumer or a good work wage slave, you know, just like the movie They Live. Right? Obey, consume, procreate, that kind of thing. The unrecognized messages of the control matrix. Well, you don't make bad karma is you move back into self-love. You have to move to self-love. Your anger to them is a lack of self-love. Me too. Look, I'm not above you, so I feel anger too. More than you, maybe. So, I'm more distorted. But I know that the solution to dissolve hatred is love, of course. Starting with self-love, of course. Manifest as seeking truth. Seeking truth is love. And those who don't seek truth don't live in love. And those who live in love want the truth. That's why they're not fools, even when they're wrong. Because they're not arrogantly defending folly. They're sincerely seeking truth. And we can recognize when we're wrong. I want to recognize when I'm wrong. But a fool doesn't. A fool takes wrong view and arrogates it into some kind of weapon for self-defense and emotional self-bolstering, meaning some kind of fake self-empowerment. And so the way to not gain bad karma is to treat them with love wisdom. Now, love says, oh, yeah, But that's folly, too, or at least it's immature. With wisdom is you see them clearly. These people arrogantly believe this. And that's just where they're at. They have wrong view, and they have low self-esteem, of course. Of course. Why does a person reject truth that doesn't conform to current belief? Basically, because that truth is considered a threat to emotional self-integrity. Emotionally based sense of self. Emotionally based positive sense of my wholeness. I am good. I am me. And I am these beliefs, which happen to be wrong. And there's no further seeking, actually, because they're not seeking truth. They're seeking self-elevation. They're seeking power over in a certain way, or at least they're seeking to like themselves again. Yeah, you need to, first of all, we have to see clearly. It's a fearlessness in seeing. This is the discipline, a portion of the discipline of understanding. So, I mean, the discipline of understanding is the primary teaching that Ra said. And we shouldn't forget, you know, look in the mirror, see the Creator. Look at another self, see the Creator. The moment contains love. So, in time and space, or space and time, these people are arrogant and wrong. And that's, you know, the definition of a fool. Arrogantly defending the wrong. Now, they are open or not open. Some are, some aren't. Everybody's somewhat, more or less, open or not. And that should be recognized too. See, the Creator means that, you know, that's their essence is your essence, which is the one infinite. Yet still also in time and space, this is not a person I like, or it's pointless for me to talk, or they really are not interested in other view, and I'm not happy here. And that's okay. And I know why. Because these are not my people. They're not my people. And they know me. So, and they're all negative. You know, at this point, the light is so bright that those who are on board the negative ship, they know they're going on the left. They know they're going negative. They know it now. And they're too deep to get out because they're dependent on the matrix. They're dependent on that system. And that's a bad deal. I do feel sorry for them, actually. That's new for me, which is interesting. So these are not your people, actually. Your people are uniformly in love and truth. And happy joy together, you know, happy community. That's where you're from. That's where you're going. But your anger to them is resonant with their anger to the world. And this is a further opportunity for disengagement to see how you're not like them. But arguing with them puts you at that level. And so, you know, rather than argue, you ought to be grieving. Grieving, not forever. That's just temporary too. So anger is a blockage distortion that has some utility or some value in the personal self, like it makes me feel stronger. And I don't have to feel helpless and weak. But it's a defensive cover to avoid sorrow, broken heart, and grief. Then that too is not permanent and is a cover for a deeper level disappointment. But below that comes the dawn of the light of truth and joy, which is that this is a short time gig. I'm here with them because I tripped and fell and made some trouble in past lives with them, with others, with that ideology, with that, you know, you're the aggressor, I'm the victim, and I can do anything I want, therefore. That's the mentality, you know. You hurt me, you're bad, I'm good, therefore I can spit on anybody I want at any time. I deserve that. I mean, you hurt me always. You are against me always. I'm a victim of that always. And that's all. And therefore, I can do anything I want. And you are always bad, and I'm always good. And that's all. And that's the end of that. Because you always hate me, but we're actually the best. That's the view. That really is their view. At some level. And that's why they're trauma-based mind control. To, at some level, feel like they deserve to be evil. I can do anything I want because I was traumatized. It's very tangled, and it is not going to get them into 4D negative, for sure. So, and you need to know that, and you know, I mean, we all are with people that we shouldn't be with fully. We're karmically tied. We're karmically associated. Not essentially. So the association is karmic in time and space based on the residue of past lives. True association that we will move into and will enjoy is that of essential soul vibration or higher self, you know, essential soul vibration, let's say. Home family. Those who truly, you know, who truly value love and truth as we do. Period. Yeah, above the law, the belief they're becoming a god. Yeah, you know, and it's all based on ignorance. That's the funny thing, you know. It's all based on an exclusion of reality. Like they'll never consider who the positive ETs are. They'll never consider who they really are. They only know their body and their mind and society. And if they're shown about, you know, other worlds or something, at that level, it's all coming through a negative filter. So they're profoundly misinformed. And that's the way it goes, right? If I'm a top dog, I don't want my lower dogs to know the truth. I'll feed them lies always. I'll give them a little truth and a little lie. I have to keep them in. I give them some perk and then I slap them around. That's the way you have to run it. That's the way negative organizations run. Knowledge or truth is power, and it must be carefully kept from everybody below me. Of course. And when a person gets out of line, they're taken out. So it's the negative situation is a mind control, you know, organization. The whole group. More or less, right? Because it's all about control. And that's the key. That's the very simple point that I realized. It's not hard to imagine. And it's not weird, actually, that they're all trauma-based mind controlling each other or top-down. Because it's a path of control. It's all about control. So you've got to be controlling everybody, everything. They have to control their emotions. They have to control their body. They have to control their mind, and they have to control everyone below them, which means you have to control the body and the mind of everyone below them, not just body. So they control the mind of everyone below, they control the mind of everybody who's non-elite, That they would feel too small, so they don't look around to keep thinking. Yeah, you mean if they kept looking around, they might think maybe they're not on top. Yes, of course. They're actually not so different than other people in a way. You know, they actually have the same frailties and confusions and needs, emotional process as everybody else. You know, and that's why they want to keep their wife. They want to keep their husband, or they want to keep somebody, because they're not really finished with heart chakra. So they're poor students of negativity. So I would say they're all controlled. And part of it actually is a recognition of the inferiority of the lower. If you're lower, it's because you're inferior. If I'm upper, it's because I'm superior. Therefore, you don't deserve truth, number one. And I don't like you anyway. That's why you're inferior. And therefore, you deserve whatever I can dish out and you can't stop. Whatever you can't stop, you deserve. And that's how they treat society. You know, however society cannot take care of itself, that's what society deserves because they're inferior. But I would say that Orion realize the inadequacy of their inferiors and treat them accordingly. So, you know, they are what they are. We are what we are. We're only here with them because we don't know love enough. And we also we're involved in the larger sacrifice of being in 3D as a contract to offer, you know, help to the Logos and work through very subtle distortions we have. So, but anyway, thank you everybody for coming today, and see you next week. Okay, good night.